Someone just told me to repeat that quick sort, right? So I'll just repeat it, that quick sort. I'll just tell you that quick sort, and then we'll start with the next one. Okay. First, I'll just share my screen. So, is it visible? My screen. Okay, I'll just tell you the quick sort, right? As I said in last lecture, this quick sort and merge sort, these two sorting techniques are used that divide and conquer strategy, right? It means first aim is to divide that array into two parts, right? So on which criteria we are dividing, that is important here in quick sort and merge sort. So let me see the quick sort. See, in quick sort, actually that division is the most important, because in the merge sort, for the division we are using that low plus high divided by 2. It means we are taking the 0 plus last point index, that is the n, consider 0 plus n divided by 2, right? So whatever that index is coming, that we are considering as a midpoint in merge sort. But in quick sort, that thing is not there. In quick sort, division is most important. Division is actually taking the time, right? So here, for the division, we use that quick sort. These are the three the steps we know: this divide, conquer, and combine. So with one example, I'll just tell you the quick sort. So first step is find the pivot element that divide the array into two halves, right? So here, that as I said, the division is most important. So first we need to consider that division, right? One minute, I'll just wait. I'm getting some kind of disturbance. Okay, sorry, some disturbance was here. See, first point is to find out that pivot element and just place that pivot element somewhere into that array, so that that array will be divided into two part, and left side of that pivot would be smaller and right side of that pivot would be greater. That is the thing, right? So to keep that pivot element at the appropriate location, for that we have a procedure. So that procedure is most important. The rest thing is that simple one, right? So just take one example. Already I just explained it, I'll again explain here. We can consider any element from this list as a pivot element. That is the thing, right? Any element you can consider, first element, last element, or random, any element you can consider that element as a pivot element. And with respect to that pivot element, we just apply that procedure. So here, I just consider that first element as a pivot element, right? That is a simple one because not necessary to memorize that one. So first element, I just consider as a pivot element. And with respect to that pivot, we need to follow the two steps. One is we need to take one index, that is I, and second index as a j. So keep in your mind that I will just traverse from left to right. It means that I will increment and j will decrement. But see, when I will increment, so that I will increment and will stop somewhere. Suppose here that I is stopping and j is also decrementing. So decrement and that j will also stop somewhere. After stopping that I and j both, we need to swap I and j values. Getting my point? I will increment and stop somewhere. J will decrement and stop somewhere. After stopping these two I and j, so I and j values will be swapped. This is one step. Right? Second step is, now suppose I and j, I is just moving to this direction and j is moving to this direction. Suppose I and j value gets crossed. It means I becomes greater than j. This is second step. Huh? So I and j value get crossed because I is moving in this direction and j is moving in this direction. So when I and j value get crossed, or we can say when I value becomes greater than j value, in that case, swap j and pivot element. Keep in your mind, swap this j value and pivot element. And after swapping this, you will observe that pivot is placed at appropriate location and left side of that pivot would be smaller and right side of that pivot would be greater. Have understood these two steps? Again, I'll just repeat. So I will increment and will stop somewhere. J will decrement and will stop somewhere. When I and J will stop, so swap that I value and J value, right? This is one step. Second, when I increment and J decrements, and when I value becomes greater than J value, it means I and J when crossed. So after becoming I value greater than j, so that j value and pivot element you just swapped. So swapping is here two times. One is I and j swapping and second is pivot and j swapping. When pivot and j swapped, so you will observe that pivot will be placed at somewhere into that array so that that left side will be smaller and right side would be greater. It means that array is been partitioned. Have understood this explanation at least? So the same thing I just written here. See, this whatever is the code segment I have written here, this is for simply incrementing that I. So what is the condition? When A of I is less than or equals to pivot, then simply increment. Now here, this is equal, so increment. I'll show you, right? You can see here that 50 and the 50, it is comparing with itself. So that's why that I will increment. You can see that I is at second position at first index. Then again that 30 and 50 will be compared. So 30 is smaller than pivot, or we can say pivot is greater. So again you need to increment. So this pivot, this 50, and I is incremented till that get the greater element, that is a 90, right? So now stop here. So that I will stop because that condition gets fails. Now after stopping that I value, let that think about the j, right? Now we'll write code for the j. You can see this code is for the j. When a of z is greater than pivot element, then decrement that z value. Right? It means you can understand that I is searching the greater value and j is searching the smaller value. Getting my point? I is searching the greater value than pivot and j is searching smaller value than pivot. And then stop. So here 30 we are comparing with 50, so that 70 we are comparing with the 50, so 70 is greater than 50. So what we can do, we can decrement because 70 is greater and we are searching the smaller value. So we can see here now 40. Now compare 40 and 50, so 40 is smaller, so you can stop here. So as I said, this is the first step. Now decrementing j gets stopped, incrementing that I gets stopped. Now we need to swap this 90 and 40. Getting my point? Just compare this 90 and 40, compare and swap, and also that check the condition that I should be smaller than j, because next condition when I becomes greater than j, then we are swapping with the pivot element. But here we are not swapping with the pivot element, so that's why you need to check that condition I should be smaller than j. So I is 3 and j is 6, this index, right? So you can see here, then in that case you can swap here. So after swapping, that 90 will come at the 40 location place and 40 will come at 90 place. So you can see here, this has been swapped. 90 comes here and 40 comes here, okay? Now again you can see that 90 is greater than pure, so actually from right side we are searching the smaller element, but this is a greater element, and from the left side we are searching the bigger element, but this 40 becomes smaller. So again we need to increment that I and decrement j. So you can see here, I will increment, right, 80. So 80 is what? That is a greater element, so stop here. Now think about j. Now you can see here, this will decrement, so 20 is a smaller element, again stop. Now again here 80 and 20, you just swap these two values. Now this you need to swap, so you can see this 20 comes at the 80's location and that 20 goes at the 80 comes at the 20 and 20 comes at the 80, right? So this one. Now see, again this 80 becomes greater and the j value becomes greater and I value becomes smaller. Again I will increment and j will decrement. So you can see here, so when that I comes here and j comes here, it means this I and j value get crossed. So I becomes greater than j because I value is 5 and j value is 4. You can see here, I value is 5 and j value is 4. In that case, you need to swap this j value with pivot element. You can see this pivot element. So here that explanation I have written here. Here I value becomes greater than j means I and j value gets crossed. In this case, swap pivot and j value, that is 50 and 20. So we need to swap this 50 and 20. So this has been swapped. Now here you can observe, whatever is the left side of this 50 is the smaller than pivot or 50, and whatever is the right side of this pivot is the greater than. You understood? So this is the placing, or we can say division, we can say, right? So this is a pivot element we put here, and this becomes the one subarray and this becomes the second subarray. So you can see here that the same thing. Now this is the one subarray and this is the second subarray. So you can apply that same procedure for this subarray and same procedure for this subarray. So you can continue this till you get single element into the array. Getting it? So once we get single element, that combine is there, sorting is there, so you will get this final array. Getting this? So we have understood this. This is the recursive function. That function, whatever things I just explained, the same things have been written over here in this function also. So, any doubt in QuickSort? Any doubt? Because I just repeated this thing. Anything? Or shall I move for the next? Okay. If no reply, it means you don't have any doubt, I'll assume. Okay. Now, see, there shows the sorting and sorting. We have seen bubble sort, selection sort, insertion sort, quick sort, and merge sort. And we have seen the two searching techniques, linear search and binary search. So, this was enough for the sorting. Now, we are moving toward the next and most important part from this data structure, that is the linked list, right? But before just moving toward the linked list, one concept I need to clear here, right? So this is the dynamic memory allocation. So first I need to tell you the concept about the dynamic memory allocation, and then I just move toward the linked list concept, okay? So see, whatever the concept we have seen till today, all these are concerned to static memory allocation. Now, next concept is also there, that is a dynamic memory allocation. So I'll just tell you what is difference between static memory allocation and dynamic memory allocation. If you see that the definition, so if we allocate that memory at compile time, then that is nothing but the static memory allocation. And if we allocate that memory at runtime, it means that is a dynamic memory allocation. But these are the definitions, okay? But the allocation of memory at compile time means what, and allocation of memory at runtime means what? Now see, one example I just tell you. If you are using array concept, right? So in that array, we declare that array like A of 10, right? So what is the meaning of A of 10? A of 10 means it will reserve 10 consecutive blocks, right? And each block size would be 2 bytes if it is integer type, right? If I am saying int A of 10, so it will reserve 10 consecutive blocks. So when we just write the code, at that time we need to decide the size of array. Listen carefully. When we write the code, at that time we need to decide the size of array. And once we fix that size, so that size will be fixed for entire program. Whenever you just run that program, that compiler will reserve that much memory. That compiler will not think whether you are using that full memory or half memory or that exceeding your memory. So that compiler don't think. So whatever the memory you just reserve at writing the code, that will be reserved, right? So what is the drawback of that static memory allocation? So one thing is, suppose you just reserve or you just declare that array A of 100, suppose, right? That array size is 100. Now that compiler will reserve that 100 consecutive blocks of the memory. 100 into 2, so 200 bytes if it is integer type. So I'll just use a term that is a block, okay? So it will reserve 100 blocks. And when we run actually, so what we do at the time of running, so we ask to the user how many records you want to enter. Normally that user says 5 records, right? So when we just enter the 5 records, it means whatever are the 95 blocks, these blocks we waste. Only out of 100, we use only 5 blocks, and rest 95 block we waste, right? So it means that is a wastage of memory. That is one thing. Second thing is, suppose 100 blocks you just reserve, and your requirement is more than 100. Suppose you want to store the records of the 200 students or something, or 105 or 120. So in that case, that insufficient memory would be there. because your reservation is of 100 blocks and your requirement is 100 and something, right? In that case, insufficient memory problem would be there. This is the second, the drawback, the main drawback. And third drawback is, in memory, you need that much memory in consecutive manner free, right? So if you just declare int a of 100, so that there should be a free memory, and there should be a 100 free blocks in consecutive manners, right? So if suppose the consecutive 100 blocks are not there, then again insufficient, the memory problem would be there, because we need that in consecutive manner, right? Because array reserve that memory in consecutive manners, right? So these are the drawbacks of static memory allocation. Now that solution to the static memory allocation is the dynamic memory allocation. So dynamic memory allocation means what? When you run program, not while writing, when you run your program, when that black screen comes to you in front of you, at that time, when that program says how many records you want to enter, if you say 10, so only 10 blocks will be reserved. Getting my points? At the time of running your program, if you say 10 records, so only that memory for that 10 records will be reserved. Again, suppose second time you are running that same program and that same thing asks how many records. So suppose you said 20 records, so only 20 blocks will be reserved. It means there is no advance booking of that memory, we can say, right? So at the time of need, that memory will be reserved. Have you understood my point? So this is the biggest advantage of this dynamic memory allocation. And that same concept we are using in linked list. So I'll just tell you the simple the functions, inbuilt functions are there for the dynamic memory allocation. So that I'll just tell you, right? So you can see here, these are the function. One more function is also there, that is a free, that I'll just tell you afterward. So malloc, calloc and realloc. So these are the three functions we use for this dynamic memory allocation. And that header file use, that is include alloc.h, here that the name is written, that alloc.h, that header file is required for all these functions, right? So malloc and calloc both are used for the initial reservation of the memory, right? And realloc is for the reallocation of that memory. Only that is the meaning of these three. Malloc calloc functioning is same, only the syntax is different. Right. So if you see this, the malloc syntax, so this is a PTR is a pointer, right? And this is a cast type, that malloc is a function name and that byte size. So here in case of malloc function, you can see here only single parameter is been passed here. So one syntax is also given, one example is also given here. PTR is a pointer that will store the address of whatever that function will return, right? So int, because here whatever the type of this, that will be stored here. Malloc and n into size of that int. This is an example. So when I just give you example, you will understand this syntax also. So only here you just understood the only single parameter is being passed here. This is n into size of int, so this is a single parameter. But when we say the calloc, so two parameters are there. So that rest syntax is the same. Only here the number of parameters are here two. So here n comma size of int. Getting my point? So here this is the in previous function, that is malloc. So multiplication was here. So that was the, you can see here, this was the same or single parameter, but here the two parameters are there. One is n and second one is the size of this int, right? So this is only difference between malloc and calloc. And this is the realloc function syntax. This is similar to your calloc, only this is for the reallocation of the memory. So the rest things are same, only here that function name is different, otherwise it is having two parameters. One is the n and second one is the size of int. This is the second parameter, right? So these three functions we use. One more function is we are using here, that is a free. Free means what? Suppose the when you just run your program using these function, you reserve some memory, and when you exit your program, so whatever is the reserve memory, that should be free. So when we say free, so that memory will be utilized by any other function or another program, right? So free function is also there, that is a simply free. And what you need to free, that one parameter you need to pass, that is a pointer parameter, right? Like suppose here we have reserved some memory and this address is stored into this pointer. So when you want to free this whatever is the memory reserve, so you can say free and pass this parameter, that is a PTR, right? So that will be erased, we can say, or deleted. Okay, so one example I have just shown here. The same example we have sent using the array, but if you see here, that array is not being used, right? It means when we write the program, we have not reserved that the memory in advance. Only here we have taken one pointer variable, that is a p, and these are the normal ordinary variables. And here I have asked the how many elements. Suppose n elements means suppose 5, consider that value n of 5. So it means you are reserving the consecutive 5 blocks for the array, right? If n value is 2, so only you will reserve 2. If n value is 1, you will reserve simply single block. If n value is 100, so it will reserve 100 blocks, right? So how it will reserve 100 blocks? So here that function is given. This is a p is a pointer variable. And you can see here n is what? N is the number of blocks. And what is the size of one block, right? Size of that one block, that will be calculated using the size of function, because we need the integer 10 or 100 blocks. So if you say character, so you need to write here char. So that represents the size of your block, right? So n is the number of blocks. So n into size of it. It means suppose 5 blocks if you want to reserve. So 5 into 2 is 20 byte memory will be reserved, right? So this function is used to reserve the memory, and then using this function here, I have just used that input function, that is a scanf function. So using this function, we can store that that elements into the reserve memory. You can see here the reserved, we just stored the elements into the memory, and whatever the last part, whatever the stored element, that we just displayed here using the output function, that is a printf, right? So this is very simple example, and the same example we can implement using array also. But array drawback is what? You need to specify that array size, right? So we can say roughly, not fixed. So array is a example of the static memory allocation, and linked list is the example of dynamic memory. Getting this? But here if you see this P of A of I, this is again example of the array. That's why I'm saying not fixed. Roughly you can say array is an example of the static memory allocation, and the linked list is an example of dynamic memory allocation. So we'll see that linked list concept so that you will understand this also. Okay. So this is about the dynamic memory allocation. We have seen these three functions along with the syntax, and the difference is a very little difference in these three. The first two functions, malloc and calloc, are used for the allocation of memory initially, and realloc is for the reallocation of memory, and the only they vary in the syntax, right? And header file is alloc.h. We have seen here alloc.h is the header file that we can use, right? So this was about the dynamic memory allocation. Now we'll just move toward the most important concept. But before that, if you are having any kind of query, please ask me. I'll just wait for 2 minutes. If you are having any kind of query, please ask me. In the dynamic memory allocation or in quicksort or in any of the sorting techniques. If you are having any kind of query, please ask me. Any doubt? Okay. Then let me move for the linked list data structure, right? See, linked list and array both are the linear data structures. Keep in your mind, both are linear data structures, linked list and array. Only the difference in linked list and array is what? Of an array, as I said, we need the consecutive memory at a time. But in linked list, not necessary that memory reservation in consecutive manner. So if suppose some of the memory is free at some point and second location some memory is free, so in linked list we can use both. And in linked list and array, that the main difference is the insertion and deletion of element, right? So when we consider that array, so insertion of element and deletion of the element from the array is not that much simple. The reason is, suppose you want to insert any element at first location into the array. Now what we need to do, whatever are the rest n minus 1 elements, we need to shift by one location and then we can insert that element at the first location. So here that shifting is very major part, because when we say that time complexity, so if you are wasting much time in the shifting and whatever the main operation, that is the insertion, for that you are requiring very small time, but you are wasting much time in the shifting, in the insertion, and same thing is in deletion also. Suppose that first element you want to delete, suppose zeroth location you want to delete. So whatever are the n minus 1 element, these element you need to shift by 1, right? So first element will shifted to zeroth location, then second element will be shifted at the first location, third element will be shifted at the second location, and something like that. Again, in the insertion and deletion, we need the shifting, right? So it will increase the time complexity. But in linked list, that insertion and deletion is very simple. Not necessary the any kind of shifting or something. Only we need to perform the small operation, that is a assignment of the address, and that element will be deleted and original link will be formed. Or any element if you want to insert into the linked list, so only we need to shift the addresses so that that new link will be formed, right? So we'll see here, you can see these the points we'll see in the introduction. And the linked list definition, so see, the linked list is a linear data structure and every element is having two part. One is the data part and second is the link or address part. So this one is the node structure, we can say. Every element's node structure is this one. So linked list is a data structure, linear data structure, and every element is having a node, and that node is divided into two part. One is the data part and second one is the link part or address part, you can say. So this is the node representation. And already I just told you advantages and disadvantages of this linked list. So advantages, what? Insertion and deletion is very simple. That the disadvantage is what? If you are having very small amount of the elements, or if your array or number of elements are very small, suppose 5 elements are there, right? So if you are using that array concept for the 5 elements, so in that case insertion and deletion is very simple, because shifting is very small. Only 3-4 elements you need to shift to the in the backward direction or in forward direction, right? So shifting is very small. And the total amount of memory required for this 5 element is what? 5 into 2, so 10 byte is required for that 5 elements. But if you see here, if you are using the linked list, so for a single element, this much memory is been required. This is what, suppose this is a 2 bytes and this is the address, so this is a 4 byte. So 4 plus 2, that is a 6 byte memory is required for a single element. And if you are having a 5 elements, so 6 into 5, you can see 30 bytes are required for this small array. So this is the drawback. But if you are having the very the bigger list, in that case, that linked list concept is very good, right? And second thing is for the implementation, we need to use that pointer concept. And the many people feel that pointer is the more simple thing. So that's why we can say for the implementation, this is somewhat the tough than array, right? And this node representation, you just keep in your mind here, this is address part. So whatever in this field that is used for storing the address of another node. And here purely we are storing the data. That data might be integer data, character data, float data, string data, whatever data. So that data will be stored into this data part, and here simply address, right? So you can see this is a pointer field, we can say, because this field is used to store the address of any another node. So that's why this is a pointer field. Now these are the key the terminologies we are using in the linked list. One is the data pointer. As I said, this is the data pointer, right? So this might be integer, character, float, or any string or something. And this is the linked field or the address of next node. And here that null pointer is also there. In linked list, whatever is the last node, link part or address part, that is a null. So we write here null like capital N-U-L-L. Not zero, and capital NULL, that is a null ASCII value is zero. So that's why we write or represent that link part, last node link part, using the null, and that represent that is a zero, right? And external pointer, so when we see the linked list operations, we will observe, so there are many external pointers are required in the linked list. So many external pointers are there. So that's why again we can say every external pointer is requiring some space. So that is again a drawback, because for every external point, that extra space is required. And empty list means what? If your start pointer value or head pointer value is null, it means there is no any element into the list. So that means it is an empty list. And see, every list is having a start or head pointer. Without head or start pointer, we cannot display that entire list, or we cannot find out that list into the memory, right? So to point out or to locate or to take that list, you need that head pointer or start pointer. So here I am using the terminologies or pointer, like for the first node, I am using the start pointer, right? And for a creation of new node, I just take that pointer, that is a 10. So consider this as a new node, right? So this is the linked list. Now, I just shown you this is a node structure, right? And whenever we just represent that linked list on paper, so we represent using this kind of diagram. But actually when we implement this linked list, so we need to represent this the diagrammatically represented node structure in the C form or Python form or Java form, right? So as we're taking in C, so I just shown you here the representation of node in the two format. One is a simple linked structure and second one is a complex linked structure. Simple is whatever just shown you that in previous slide, that is data and the link part or address part. And complex is what if suppose your data part is very complicated, it very large, in that case we can say that is a complex. So first that linked structure that we'll see, you can see here, this node structure shown here, right? So this data might be either integer, character or float, but this is a single data. And this link is a pointer field, and this is used to hold the address of next field. So this is a address field. And in C, this is the way to represent this node structure. Struct is a keyword, node is a structure name, right? And here, int data means this is an integer data, I just consider here. And what we did here, struct node star link. This is, we can say, self-referential pointer, this star link is. But why I have just written this start struct node? We can, we know that if you are having pointer field, then we can write that int star link. That is also valid. But what is the meaning of int star link? It means that link variable is used to store the address of any other integer variable. Getting my point? Int star link or int star p something if we write. So what is the meaning of that? If we write int star link, so that link is a variable that is used to store the address of any other integer variable. That is the meaning when we just write int star link. But I have not written that int star link. I have written this struct node star link. It means in this case, this link is a variable that is used to store the address of any another node, because this is the data type for this struct node. Getting this? And this is called as self-referential pointer, right? And again, I just created my own data type that you know very well, that is type def. I have just used here, because if I am not using this type def and this one, so every time I need to write this struct and node, right? So that's why what I did, I just use this user defined data type, that is a node, this. So type def struct node, this is a data type, and this is a capital node, capital N-O-D-E, this is my own created data type. Keep in your mind, this capital N-O-D-A is my created data type. This is not the variable. Keep in your mind, this is not the variable. This is a data type which I created. So this small N-O-D-E and capital N-O-D-E, these two are the different one, right? So this is user defined data type. So I think you might understood. And now see, whatever the sequence we have written here, that same sequence you need to write. If suppose first statement is struct node star link, and then you return suppose int data, so this will be again swapped. Getting? So as per this sequence, this node structure will be formed. Getting this? So this is a simple linked structure, and complex link structure is this one. Suppose you are having the data part is like number, salary and name, something, right? So this complete is data part and this is a link part. So I have just represented here. This is a student record, that number, salary and name, something, right? So this is a data part and this is represented here. This is a node structure. So struct student data. Getting this? Struct student, because this is the data type, so that I have written here struct student and then data. So complete name of this field is data, and inside of that number, salary and name. And that struct node star link is for this one. So you can see here, struct student is a data type for the data, and struct node is a data type for this star link. Have you understood this? So this is a complex node structure, we can say, because if you are having the bigger records, in that case you need to use this kind of records, right? Now we'll see some operations. Can I take the one or two operations here? At least the two operations I'll just take and then we'll stop here. Okay. Otherwise, you will get bored. I don't know whether you people are understanding or not. Okay. Now see. Force operation is the creation of the new node. To create a link, we first need to create a new node, and then that new node we need to connect to the start pointer or head pointer. And then that link will be formed. So here you can see I have just given the steps here for the creation of the new node. See here. First, for the creation of new node, we need a one pointer, right? So here I just taken one pointer, that is a temp pointer. And to create that pointer, this step is required. Create a new pointer, say temp. So node start temp. So what is the type of the temp? This is a node, capital N-O-D-E, right? So N-O-D-E means struct node. That is a type of this capital N-O-D-E, right? So when we just write the simple this statement, so this pointer will be formed with some garbage value, we can say, right? Now second step is reserve the memory for a node. So we need to reserve these two consecutive blocks, and whatever is the address of this block, first block, that is a base address, that we need to store into this temp, so that the temp will be linked or pointed to the node. Getting that? Suppose here 1000, that address is there of this one. So that 1000 address we need to store into the temp. And we have not written anything. It means actually the garbage values are there, but consider these are the empty. Right? So empty blocks we just reserve. And whatever the base address of these, that will be stored into temp. So how that will be happened? So using this statement. So this is a statement that is used for dynamic memory allocation. So temp is a pointer, and as we know the syntax of this malloc, this is a data type star node, this is a data type malloc, and size of node. Actually in the syntax we have seen n into size of the data type, right? But here as we are creating a single node, so we can consider 1 into size of node. So 1 into this is 1, right? So that's why I have not written here 1, but actually that 1 is into size of the node, right? So that's why I have just excluded that 1. So that syntax is temp node malloc size of node. So when we simply write this statement, so this memory will be reserved and that point, that address will be stored into the stack. Simply this is a reservation of the memory for a node, creation of a node. Now next step is what? Assign the value of data field and data, assign value to data field and null to length. Now see, this we have just reserved. Now we need to store something here and something here. Suppose I need to store here 10 value and I need to store null value here. So first I'll just tell you name of this block and name of this block so that we can access these two blocks, right? So name of this first block is temp of data. Why that is temp of data? Because here the data we have considered here, right? This block name is data and this block name is link, that we just assume. That's why the name of this block is temp. This is external pointer, temp of data, and this name is temp of link. So that's why I have just written this statement here, temp arrow, this angular bracket. See, this is an operator. This is an arrow operator that is used when you are using the structure. Normally, we use a dot operator in in pointer. Like if you say the structure concept that s dot data, s dot name, s dot prn, something we have just used, right? That was the dot operator. Now here, as we are using the pointer, so instead of the dot operator, you need to use here that arrow operator, right? So this, the change you need to consider here, because we are using a pointer concept. So for the pointer, we need to use arrow operator, and for the other things, we need to use dot operator. So temp of data, which is equals to 10, it means 10 will be assigned here. And temp of link equals to null, so that null will be assigned. So here, I was just shown here. So 10 is in the data field and null into the link field. So this node has been created. Have understood? This node has been created. This is the thing. So, and whatever the stamp value, the stamp value will have the address of this node, we can say, but actually that address of the first node, and that is called as base node, right? Base address. So that will be stored here. So whenever we print this stamp, so this entire node will be considered for the printing. And then here return the time value, right? So you understood these the steps to create a node. If you see here, I just show the function here, right? That same thing I just return into this function, because here it was kind of steps. Now this is a function, right? First step is to create a pointer, that is time. So first statement is return. For the empty reservation of the memory, this statement is written. And to store the some value into this and some value into this. So actually that value I had assigned, that is hard coded, but here I have taken that value from the user, and I have just stored that entire value from the user into temp of data. Getting this? This is a temp of data. So there I just store that value. So whatever that user will enter, that will be stored into the temp of data. And here in temp of link, I have just stored the null value. So why null? Because when we just connect this node to the link list, so every link list last node link part is the null. Getting this? So that's why we need to assign that null value to link part and return this temp, right? So this is a creation of a new node. Have you understood this? Creation of a new node. Right? Anything? Can I go for the next? Or shall I stop? Okay, I'll stop here. Otherwise, we'll get bored, right? So, we'll stop here. Getting this?